Hey, what's up everybody, and welcome back to That Triathlon Show, the podcast presented by scientifictriathlon.com. I'm your host Michael, and this episode is Q&A number 47. I would like to start today by again asking for some specific feedback, and this time what I'm interested in is knowing how much interest there is among the listeners of the podcast in episodes that would focus entirely on endurance sports that are not triathlon. So I'm not talking about episodes that are about, for example, run training in general or bike training in general or triathlon run training specifically or triathlon bike training, but actually episodes that are, for example, dedicated to runners training for the 5K or triathletes just want to mix things up and focus on the 5K or the marathon or focus on cycling time trials or cycling road racing and so on. So I could have an episode on cycling time trialing, an episode on marathon training, things like that. Let me know if that would interest you. Email michael@scientifictriathlon.com, and it's Michael with a K. And let me know whether it's a yay or a nay for you. If you just want me to keep doing the triathlon-related episodes, then I will do that, if that's what the feedback tells me. Because it is important to get this feedback so that I can go with whatever makes sense for as many listeners as possible, knowing that it's not possible to please everybody 100% all the time, but I will try to do what is best for the most amount of listeners. Big thanks to our sponsors, Precision Hydration, that you can find on precisionhydration.com. They make electrolytes that help you stay hydrated and get hydrated in the first place. And how much electrolytes you should take is actually very much an individual thing. Some athletes may lose very little electrolytes and sodium in particular in their sweat, and maybe something less than 500 milligrams per liter. Whereas for some athletes, this figure might be closer to 2,000 milligrams per liter of sweat. And if you take into account that the sweat rates of athletes may also vary significantly, then the total sweat sodium loss of athletes can have really, really great differences. And that is why the sweat test that Precision Hydration has designed, which is just a simple quiz, 10 questions that you take online in a few minutes' time, that is so great, and it's been validated against actual sweat test data and gives you a really good ballpark estimate for how much electrolytes you should consume. So take that sweat test. It's free. It's on precisionhydration.com. And if you want to try their products, you can get 20% off your entire order until the end of August only, so hurry up, with the promo code THATTRIATHLONSHOW20. That Triathlon Show is all one word, all caps. Or you can try your first box or tube for free with the code THATTRIATHLONSHOW, all one word, all caps. And thank you to Roka. Roka is the brand that redefines the standard in wetsuits, trisuits, eyewear, and several other triathlon endurance sports categories. They started as a small hobby garage hobby thing in Austin, Texas, as an attempt to simply make the fastest possible wetsuit on the market. And that little hobby project has grown to become what is Roka today, which is a world leader in manufacturing not only wetsuits, but all sorts of other apparel, which is really, really fascinating to see. The one thing that has remained the same is the dedication to trying to perfect and eke out the maximum amount of performance possible of every single product that Roka produces. And that is why I really, really support the brand and like it so much. You can check them out on roka.com and use the promo code TTS, all caps, to get 20% off your entire order. So today's first question is from Daniel in Germany, who writes, "Hi Michael, I have a question for the Q&A. How do you set up your Training Peaks dashboard? First and foremost, I'm interested in the performance management chart. Do you track TSS just for running and cycling?" Thank you for your question, Daniel. This is fairly straightforward to answer in terms of how I set it up, at least, because I have every single chart available in Training Peaks in my dashboard. And this may sound redundant, and it actually, in many ways, is redundant, because most of the time I use maybe a quarter of those charts or less. But inevitably, there will be the odd case where I do want to look at one of my non-favorite charts, the one that I use much less frequently. So I actually found it more effective to have all charts in the dashboard from the start, rather than having to add and remove charts all the time when these situations do come up. And then I just look at the charts that I want to look at whenever I want to look at them. And I don't, when I go to the dashboard, I don't look at all the charts in the dashboard. I have a specific purpose for going there, something specific that I want to look up. And the setup that I have in my dashboard is such that I have one type of chart repeated 3 to 4 times typically. So to give you an example, the duration by week chart is basically a chart that shows you week by week. So on the x-axis, you have the different weeks that is set in your time range that you have set in the main setting in the upper left corner. So let's say that you have 10 weeks shown in the chart. On each of those weeks, you will then have a bar that represents, and the height of that bar represents how much you trained in terms of duration, so total hours and minutes in that week. And I have this chart 4 times repeated. So first, all workout types together, then specifically for the swim, bike, and run separately. So I can look at the total duration, full stop, and the swim duration, the bike duration, and the run duration. And the same applies for example, the distance by week chart. Although for that one, I actually only care about the swim and the run distances, so I only have 2 of them. And even though I don't look that much at the TSS, but I do have them set up, so same sort of thing. Total TSS, then swim, bike, and run TSS separately. So 4 charts as well for the TSS by week. And the same sort of principle repeats itself on and on and on for all the different chart types that there is, basically. The thing that I should do with my setup, with my dashboard, but that I don't have at the moment, actually, is I should have all my most used charts at the top and the least used ones at the bottom. I don't have them that way because back in the day when I set up my dashboard, I had some idea for why the current setup would be good. I don't know exactly what it was, but now I know exactly how far to scroll, so I immediately get to the chart I want to look at. I really don't waste any time doing that. It's so automatic, so ingrained in my muscle memory. So that's why I haven't even bothered changing. But probably at some point I will do that, put my most useful charts at the top. All this being said, let me list the charts that I think are the most important and that I use the most in the dashboard. And if I had the opportunity, if Training Peaks offered the feature to set up several dashboards, I would definitely have a dashboard with just these charts, because that would be the dashboard I would look at 90% of the time, probably. So first, I have all the duration by week charts that I mentioned. So we see week by week with a bar, how much total volume was done that week, and by discipline as well, depending on how you have the chart set up. Then I have the distance by week that I also mentioned, same sort of thing, but for the swim and run, I also want to see the total distance. And for the run, I actually have a third chart in this category, which is the longest run distance by week. So for example, let's say that one week it was 15 kilometers, and then the next week it was 18 kilometers, and it was 20. I will see that in the bar chart as well. So taking simply the longest run from each week and drawing that in the bar chart, because that is important when I plan what the next long run is going to be. I can't have too big of a jump from what has been done before, basically. Then number 3 here in my different types of charts, I have 4 of these types of charts that are the ones that I look at almost all the time. These are the fitness history tables. And what they do is they have, it's like a grid. So on vertically on the y-axis, you have month by month. So you have the months shown. And then horizontally, you have either distance or duration. So you can think of it, if we take duration as an example, you have 5 seconds, you have 10 seconds, you have 30 seconds, you have 1 minute, 5 minutes, 20 minutes, 60 minutes, that sort of thing. So then I can see, for example, let's say I'm interested in your 5 minute power, then I can look at from this month, from August, back to July, June, May, April, and so on. I can scroll back pretty far back. It doesn't go forever, unfortunately. That's a bit of a problem with those charts, but it goes a fairly long, I think it's 12 months maybe that it goes. So I can see what your best 5 minute power for each month has been. And actually, they also show the last 4 weeks on a week-by-week basis. So I can see that as well, if that interests me. Although usually I'm more interested in the month-by-month. And I have several of these fitness history tables. So I have peak heart rate by duration, and those are for, and I have that for running and for biking. Then I have peak pace by both distance and duration for running specifically. And then I have peak power by duration, and that is for both cycling and running, because a lot of my athletes have running power meters. So those are the fitness history tables, extremely useful. I use them a lot to actually validate training zones, and also when looking at setting target paces for races. These are the charts that I will go to and figure out what has been done in training, and based on that, what can realistically be achieved in racing. If we are looking at training zones, for example, I can find the peak heart rate. Of course, I will then go in and check at the actual file to see that it wasn't a heart rate artifact, because those do occur and you need to take care of that. But it will give me an opportunity to find, yeah, I can also go the other way around and look at, for example, 20 minute power and peak 60 minute power. And that way I can assess whether the currently set FTP is more or less accurate, and I can do manual updates to that if I see that, well, actually this athlete has done quite a high 60 minute power here, so probably their FTP should be a bit higher than what it's set at. So it's really useful for those sort of scenarios as well. And finally, number four in the chart that I use, and actually the top three that I mentioned already, those ones I use all the time, like really all the time. And I don't think I could live without any one of those three. I could potentially live without number four here, but I still use it a lot and really like it. And these are the pie charts on completed duration and planned duration. So by pie charts, it means that basically we see a percentage breakdown of how much you trained in swimming and cycling and running for the time range that is set, again, in the time range setting. Let's say that we're looking at the last 3 months. So did you do 45% cycling, 35% running, and whatever is left, 20% swimming, or something like that. And I can see if that matches the planned duration more or less. So it's a tool for me to see what I have planned, and I can actually do that in advance, because I can look in the future as well with the time setting and see how much I plan for the next block and see whether that matches what I sort of want the athlete to do. But also I can use that to check the compliance of the athlete. Is it quite often the swim that gets missed, or is it the bike, or is the athlete actually very good at being compliant with the program? So that's a great tool as well. And I would say that 90% of the times that I look at a chart, any chart, it is one of these four types of charts. These all provide very actionable data for me, which is key. And a lot of the other charts, I don't always get actionable data from them. But there are scenarios when I do, which is why I still have them in the dashboard. And there are specific cases where I will go and have a look at another chart. But most of the time, it's the four ones that I mentioned already. So duration by week, distance by week, fitness history tables, and completed duration pie charts. Regarding TSS and the PMC, I do have it set up in the dashboard, and I have it in as a combined PMC for all three sports together, but also have it separately for run plus bike, and I have it separately for each of the three disciplines as well. But as I discussed on several previous Q&As, I find more and more that TSS often poses more questions than it gives answers, and I can't really trust it, to be frank. Not from a data quality standpoint, because I do try to take care of that. But I just think that the correlation between TSS and performance is quite weak. And of course, somebody with a very high average TSS is likely going to be a lot fitter than somebody with a very low TSS and therefore perform better. That's not the point I'm getting at. The point is that if I have an athlete that averages 800 TSS per week, I don't need to look at the TSS necessarily. I might change their training. And let's say that it turns out that based on the training changes I do, the TSS happens to go down to 700 per week on average, and they perform better. Or I might change their training and it actually goes up to 900 TSS per week. Again, I'm not looking to make a TSS change. I'm looking to make a training change. And what happens if the TSS goes up because of I was maybe looking more at duration or things like that. And that might have been the case in the first case as well. Or I might have been looking at intensity, reducing intensity in the former case, which drops TSS from 800 to 700. In both cases, the performance may go up, which just shows that like basing a lot of your training on on TSS is really not that smart when, in my opinion, again, this is my opinion only, but I don't think that the correlation is very strong at all. And this goes even if I know the athlete and their training. I think that actually I get much more insightful data and actionable data from looking at the duration, and I can have a much better likelihood of correctly predicting how their performance will respond by increasing or decreasing their duration rather than by increasing or decreasing their TSS. So that's just the sort of a backdrop of why I don't really look that much at the PMCs and the TSS scores anymore. I do still glance at it, especially when an athlete has a race coming up. I glance at what their CTL and TSB values are leading up to the race, and checking in what it was on race day and so on, and trying to basically see if there are any patterns there. There are some very, very broad patterns, but the truth is they are so broad that that's another reason that the PMC has kind of fallen out of favor for me. And to answer your question, if I look at just a bike plus run, no, when I do these glances, I typically look at first of all the combined PMC, the swim plus bike plus run, because it's all endurance training after all. If an athlete has a particularly good or bad bike or run or swim, then maybe I'll look at also at the specific discipline that is in question here. But again, I don't see a clear correlation between TSB or CTL and performance on race day. Again, I just think it's much easier and much more predictable to work with durations. For example, I have a pretty standard taper pattern based on duration and intensity, but we're talking about duration here mostly, because intensity more or less stays the same, but it becomes, well, proportionally it stays the same, but absolutely it becomes, there's much less intensity, of course, and maybe even a bit less proportionally. Either way, that's not the point here, but when it comes to duration, the pattern that I have is that in the first week of taper, we drop volume to 70 to 80% of peak volume. So it's not a big drop, but let's say you trained 20 hours during your peak week, then you will be training 14 to 16 hours during the second week out from the race. And in race week, we drop the volume to 50% or less of peak volume. So less than, in this case, less than 10 hours for the 20-hour athlete. And for the 20-hour athlete, it would actually be probably to less than 40%. I might drop it to 8 hours or something like that during the goal race week. And that seems to give very good results most of the time. So hope that answers your question, Daniel. Next question is from Christoph in Lisbon, who writes, hello, Michael. First of all, I would like to congratulate you on your podcast. Really great content and guests. Now on to my question, which is about volume versus frequency. I am a triathlete focused on half Ironmans, and I do my own planning. I have the question about whether to focus more on more workouts with lesser volume or fewer workouts with more volume. As an example, during base training, where I have a weekly volume of 6 hours for bike training, would it be best to do 5 workouts as 1 2-hour ride and 4 1-hour rides, or to do 4 workouts as 1 2-hour ride, 2 1.5-hour rides, and 1 1-hour ride, or even just 3 workouts? So thank you, Christoph, for your question. This is a bit individual, of course, but it depends on the goal race. It also depends on the level of the athlete. I'll get on to that in a little bit. In your example here, focusing on half and full races, and I think you are probably intermediate or advanced in your level as an athlete, I would make one of those rides, even in your base training far out from the races, I would make it longer than 2 hours. So something, it could be with 6 hours, it could be something like 2.5 plus 1.5 plus 1 plus 1. So we would go with 4 rides in that case. The 1.5-hour ride can be a quality ride, and some intervals. One of the one-hour rides can have some technical elements to it. It could be cadence work, or it could be maybe even some short and sharp speed work, like very short sprints. And the last one-hour ride could be just an easy ride, something like that. But I would say, even for a half Ironman, but especially if you were to train for an Ironman, then I would probably recommend that maybe every other week during base training, far out from the races again, we could drop down to just 3 workouts per week. Again, just every other week. And in that week, we would try to build up that long ride and make it longer. So we could go to 3 hours, and then the next week that we do that, we would go to 3.5 hours and so on, to a degree. So maybe as long as you're indoors, if you are not somebody who is a bit crazy like me and some of my athletes, we like to do long rides indoors, going up to 5 hours or longer in some cases. But for most, 3.5 hours is more than enough. And I would say that in base training, it's definitely more than enough for training for a half Ironman especially. But still, we would like to maybe every other week drop down from 4 rides to 3 rides, assuming that you have the same 6 hours to train with, and make sure that one of those rides is a bit longer than the 2.5 hours that I had in that previous example with 4 rides per week. For the run, things can be a bit different, and in base training, far out from the races again, you probably aren't going to run any longer than 75 minutes for quite a long period of your base training. Maybe 90 minutes, it depends a bit on your level and your injury history. It actually depends a lot on that. It could be 90 minutes, but for many athletes, actually, there's no need to run any longer than 75-minute long runs for base training. That's my opinion. But you could still be doing quite a lot of running just by building frequency. So when it comes to building run volume, it definitely happens first through more frequency, and only later on, as you get closer to your key races, you would start to increase the duration of that long run. Of course, this is due to the higher injury risk when doing those long runs individually compared to cycling, where it really isn't that much more of an injury risk. Well, I mean, of course it is, but comparatively speaking, cycling is a fairly... It's a sport that isn't that high of a risk of injury compared to running. So that's why we do things a bit differently when it comes to running, or that's what I recommend anyway. For the swim, it does depend a bit on your pool availability as well, like how close do you have your pool? Is it a hassle to get there, and does it take up a lot of your commuting time? But I do like to fairly quickly build up to one longer swim per week. A longer swim here might still only be 75 minutes or so, depending on your overall swim volume, and also depending on your level. If you're a pretty slow swimmer, then 75 minutes might not be necessary. Maybe you only go to 60 minutes, but you try to get more frequent swim workouts in. Because I think that for somebody who isn't a very good swimmer, frequency trumps duration of individual workouts for sure. Just to get more used to, get more frequent exposure to swimming and feel for the water, and therefore more rapid learning of the actual technical elements of swimming. In general, to give some general guidelines, I think that for people newer to triathlon or endurance sports, frequency is more important and less risky. So that's what I recommend going for as you're more at the beginning end of the spectrum or starting out in the sport. For more intermediate to advanced athletes, you do want to and need to think about what the right duration for your long workout in each or workouts in each discipline should be, based on where you are in your season and what your goal race is, etc., etc. But you do need to consider that. Like for example, for an Ironman athlete, you already during base training want to be doing some fairly long bike rides. We don't need to do 5 hours on the trainer through winter long, definitely not. But you want to build up to that 3 hour level, I think, if you have ambitions to perform well. It doesn't mean though that just because the individual workout duration becomes more important as we get more advanced, it doesn't mean that we go from one end of the spectrum to the other. We still need to find the right balance between frequency and the volume of individual workouts. And frequency remains very important for athletes of all levels. So to put it like this, I think this is going to illustrate what I mean here. I think there is a massive drop in potential performance when you go from 3 workouts per week in a single discipline, let's say cycling or let's say swimming, to 2. So there you see a massive drop in performance when the frequency goes from 3 to 2. There is also a clear drop-off when you go to from 4 to 3. But compared to the massive drop-off, this is clear, but it is not as big. And there is a drop-off when you go from 5 to 4, but it is quite small. Actually, for some athletes, if you are already at your limit, you're already pushing the limits of what you can handle, then it might be a negative to go from 4 to 5 for sure. So that needs to be taken into account as well. But for somebody who can do 5 workouts per week, it can still be a drop-off in potential performance to a drop down frequency, but it is going to be quite small, to be honest. Hope this helps, Christoph, and thank you for your question. Final question for today is from Bertrand, who I don't know if I have your location, Bertrand, but either way, Bertrand writes, Hi, Michael, I'm a firefighter officer, and sometimes while on night duty, I end up not sleeping at all or very little while still having to work the next day. So long naps are out of the picture. Following your maximum adaptation, not maximum stress principle, I know that in that case, I'm not primed to trigger any useful adaptation to a stressful workout. But still, I'd like to know if there's anything I can do these days. Can I do easy running or cycling or low to moderate intensity swimming? Can I do strength training, which to me is the easiest to do close to its normal intensity on these days? Or is there anything else that I can do? Thanks in advance for your opinion. All right. Great question, Bertrand. And as I'm sure you know, there are a lot of variables to this question, of course. But let's start off from the most important points. First, you are absolutely right. When you are sleep deprived like that, there's no point trying to do a very stressful workout, like an interval workout or even a long run or a long ride. Second, if you choose to do a not so taxing workout, like one of the ones that you mentioned, some easier running or cycling or low to moderate intensity swimming or even strength training, then follow the guideline that you should feel as good or better when you finish the workout as you did when you started it. I repeat that because it's important. You should feel as good or better when you finish the workout as you did when you started it. And I have a great personal example from today by the time that I record this episode, because it was very warm tonight and I didn't sleep very well and felt tired and lethargic waking up. And also my heart rate variability, which I measure with HRV for training, and that's actually something that I'd recommend that you do as well. It was a clear drop in my HRV. It was in the red. So that was something that I took note of, even though I'd never let HRV control my training, but I take note of it, and it informs my decisions rather than drives my decisions. So what I ended up doing was that I got up, I got breakfast and everything. I worked from 6:30 to 10. And I didn't feel dead. I didn't feel quite good, feel very good, but I didn't feel dead at least. So I decided to do a 1 hour easy spin at 10 o'clock in the morning. And an easy spin here, that was 50% of my FTP. My heart rate was less than 100, was the average heart rate for the workout. And so you don't need to go quite that easy if you're not like super tired, but it doesn't hurt to do that either. And the great thing here for me was that I could feel myself starting to feel better as I went through the spin. And that gave me confidence that, okay, this is actually good. I'll keep doing it. So I did that 1 hour spin. And then since I had a good response to that easy bike, a bit later in the afternoon, I went to do an easy swim just to keep up my feel for the water. And again, this comes back to the frequency question that we had previously. I want to keep up my frequency when swimming. So, but rather than doing anything extreme, I just swam an hour, 3,500 meters, slightly more than 1 hour perhaps, and mostly easy, but I did a little bit of strength works, so swimming with bands only, and I did two sets of 12 times 50 meter with descending speed, so descending in groups of three, so zone one, zone two, zone three, and then going back, zone one, zone two, zone three, effort levels, that sort of thing, and the second set of 12 by 50 I did with paddles. So nothing here was very hard, and nothing more than 50 meters at zone three. That was the hardest thing that I did, really. And nothing caused significant heart rate spikes. But again, I felt better and better through the session, and changes in pace felt like they woke up my nervous system a little bit. And you can do similar things to that in running or cycling by doing things like strides or doing short cadence fin-ups on the bike. But for the most part, try to keep a very easy intensity, and then you can add these sort of things that are designed to sort of try to see if your nervous system is awake or not. Strength and conditioning, yes, that is potentially possible. Maybe not an explosive strength session or a maximum strength session, but something a bit more moderate that is designed to maintain your strength gains. Or something focused on core strength and stability. So absolutely doable to do those things as well. Again, keep in mind that the guiding principle for you will be that after the workout, you should feel as good or better as before. And you should feel that it doesn't make you more tired. If anything, it should make you less tired for the rest of the day. So for the work that you still have to do that day. Also think about whether doing training versus not doing training is impacting the following day or not after you've had a proper night's sleep when getting off your shift. And I do think, as mentioned, that heart rate variability, HRV, could be useful for you to try in your line of work. First of all, perhaps if after a night of no sleep, if your HRV really, really tanks, and I mean drops extremely, then that's probably something that you should take note of and take as a sign that maybe complete rest is better than anything else today. If it is low, like mine was this morning, then it might not mean that you don't train, but that you just make sure that you keep it very easy. Also, another thing that HRV could do for you is that if you do end up training that day, so you do maybe an easy spin as we discussed, then follow the trends of what happens to your HRV the following day. Does it still come up just as fine, assuming that you have a good night's sleep the night after, as it would have if you had not trained the day before? So you need to gather some data there and see what happens. But if the HRV can come back up to its normal level, normal baseline level, even though you trained during that tired day that you had before, then that's probably an indication that the training did not extend the recovery period that your autonomic nervous system needed, which is a good thing. But if, on the other hand, you notice that if you train on those days when you haven't slept, that means that your HRV remains low even after a night sleep, then maybe it might be better to actually don't train on those days, because it might be that you're actually getting so little sleep that even the little amount of training that you do causes even more recovery demands on your nervous system. And that's something that is going to, in the long run, give you less adaptation rather than more adaptation. So I hope that this helps. Bertrand, thank you for a really great question. And that's a wrap for this week's Q&A. Thank you to everybody who has been leaving reviews and ratings for the podcast. I'm up at 499 reviews now. Ratings. Reviews are the written things and ratings are just when you leave the stars. So 499 ratings. Please, please, please take this week and help push the podcast past that 500 barrier now. And please also write a review when you rate it, even if it's super short, even if it's just a fantastic podcast. Those reviews are like 4 times as valuable as just a rating, even though a rating in itself is of course great. But if you can add a little bit of text to that, that goes even longer. I want to read one, which is from Alex Fuller Try in the United States, who writes, "For those that want evidence-based action plans, 5 stars. I'm an upper pack triathlete, in part because of the great insights that triathlon show has given. The show gives the science behind how to improve and actionable ways to incorporate into training. The guests vary on training approaches, and there's no single, here's what you should do, but rather multiple points of view and suggestions to try. It is definitely a podcast to listen to if you want to improve as a triathlete." Thank you. That's great to hear, Alex. Really appreciate that. Finally, big thanks to our sponsors, Precision Hydration, that you can find on precisionhydration.com. Take their free online sweat test to get a personalized hydration strategy for your next race. And use the promo code THATTRIATHLONSHOW, all one word, all caps, to get your first box or tube for free. Or the promo code THATTRIATHLONSHOW20 to get 20% off your entire order through the end of August. And thank you to Roka for sponsoring That Triathlon Show. You can find wetsuits, trisuits, swim skins, goggles, and high-performance eyewear on roka.com, and you can get 20% off your entire order with the promo code TTS, all caps. Thank you, as always, for listening. Keep training smart, and keep loving triathlon.